What is up? What it is? I be that Sequential Geek. Welcome to my channel. This be Comic Book Hall 69, part 27. That's right, you hear that sax? I just found out about Eddie Lockjaw Davis. He's the one on sax that you're listening to. Found out about it from Mr. Jim Steranko. That's right. June 3rd. North of downtown, still Denver area, the Rocky Mountain Con. Special guest, Jim Steranko. No video, no pictures allowed.
So no video is allowed, or photographs?
Correct.
Can I get that?
I don't see it.
Okay.
From far away? I don't know.
When I have a connection with the beast, something else happens on that page.
Nice size convention, though. Gotta say.
God damn. I mean, living, trying to survive for the past 20 years, and then you meet somebody as straight up and as cool. I wish all my coworkers and neighbors were like this guy. Life would have been so much easier. God damn. Dying breed right here in America. Jim Steranko. Fucking A. Such an awesome time talking to him. Very genuine, straight up, assertive, awesome person. Made sure to show up with like 5 questions. Didn't want to waste the guy's time, but he was such a conversationalist. There was no skin off his back. Can't say that the line was like, 50 people or maybe at the most 20 people were waiting. Small little local con. I lucked out. I'm glad that he didn't go to some of the other shops in the direct Denver area. So to have him be at this RMC con, it's just awesome. Yeah, thank God he was not at Mile High. He was at RMC. Got his autograph, though. Thank God. That was fucking cool. He had a bunch of prints. There was some calendar that he worked on with some leftover prints. He didn't have all the months, just copies that he had. April, I thought was pretty cool. All of them were pretty awesome. I asked him, what did I ask him? I said, how does it feel to be the inspiration behind Mr. Miracle? And he said how, he's like, put it another way. I'm like, well, you're an escape artist. You were the inspiration for the story. And he said, I was the inspiration for Chaban, for Mission Impossible, for some Bond stuff. He just started going off about how his background and as an escape artist and his connections with Houdini and how he was just 1 degree separation of people that knew Houdini and he had access to Houdini's notes and just some great storytelling that this guy went off on, talking about how he tied himself to a Ferris wheel and while he was upside down, when the ropes were getting loose, he fell. Part of one of the carts into the chairs and the Ferris wheel broke his fall. But, state troopers came, tied him to the Ferris wheel, and while he was upside down, he fell. And he said that story, Jack Kirby really wanted to hear more about those types of stories, and then 6 months later, he said the creation of Miracle Man. He was in the office of Carmine Infantino, and Carmine was telling him how Jack Kirby was inspired by Jim Steranko to do Mr. Miracle, and he just... It was awesome to hear him talk about hanging out with Jack Kirby. And then, Mr. Steranko, I asked him, which hand did you use to slap Bob Kane with? Which hand did you use to slap Bob Kane? He burst out laughing. And he was like, you know, normally I don't talk about that. I don't want to go off about that. I don't bring that up. But he goes, since you brought it up and I liked your other question, he's like, yeah. And he went off about the story about in 2014 at the San Diego Comic-Con in the hotel. He mentioned his book to Bob Kane, The History of Comic Books. It was like the first book about the history of comics by Jim Steranko. And Bob Kane was like correcting him and saying that Jim Steranko gave people too much credit in one aspect about Batman, the creation of Batman. And then when Bob Kane left the elevator, he gave kind of like a fake hit, like a nudge on Steranko's cheek, but it was more like a hit. Kind of slow motion, but it was real insulting. And Steranko, when he saw him the next day at the con, he said he walked up to him and bitch slapped the guy. And he said that he was a little bitch and didn't fight back, didn't say anything, just took it. And he gave him his peace of mind, and Bob Kane sat there, didn't say a word. Steranko said he made sure to stand there for 10, 20 seconds just to give Bob Kane a chance to respond, and he didn't. So, just everybody around me, I was listening to the questions, and we all were just like gasping, laughing, and it was awesome. Just how straight up. The whole time I was talking to Jim Steranko, you could see his eyes through these sunglasses, and he didn't seem off. He was giving me eye contact. I was looking at him straight in the eye. His eyes were not wandering. He didn't seem lucid. He was very awake, alert, and he didn't seem like he was on anything. The guy was born in 1944. And he's having a conversation about anything with one person after the next. It's very impressive, very friendly, genuine personality. Real quick, I asked him about Guido Crapax, the Italian artist, to see if he had much influence on him. Not specifically Guido Crapax, the Italian cartoonist. But he mentioned some other European artists, and he said that he's heard of Guido Crapax, but a lot of Euro artists were an inspiration for him. And then I asked him about the Butler Institute in Youngstown, Ohio. And in Youngstown, Ohio, he has an exhibit at the Butler Institute, but it's not traveling. And it includes his paintings that he made for the development of Indiana Jones. And he said that, like the Denver Museum here, he said that they have everything scheduled out 3 to 5 years in advance. I think 5 years. So he says it's not as easy as you think for setting up gallery tours. But I know he went on a tour in Spain in 2002 and also in Canada in 1978 that started in Winnipeg. So to be continued as far as his gallery tour. So yeah, I got comics. Yes, I did. Caliber. I'll just go through this quick back issue haul. Some really nice serendipity during this haul at the Embassy Suites. Just check this out real quick. This was for five. And there's a spread page in here that I thought was really impressive. Damon Storm. So yeah, I found out about Eddie Lockjaw Davis, the saxophonist that we're listening to. It's pretty cool that Steranko wanted to make sure that jazz was playing in the background. This is written by Joe Martin, pencils by Craig Brassfield, inks by William Traxtile. Just wanted to show some really skilled art here from early Caliber comics out of... What year is this? I don't know. I'm guessing early 90s? Shit, I cannot... Hold on. 1997, I believe. Damon Stormwalker. awesome for an indie comic caliber. It's a special. It's like a one-shot. There, this is the spread that led me to buy this. Pretty cool, huh? The Damon Storm. Then I ended up buying this. Some more 90s goodness. It's unopened collector's edition, right? Hardware. This was for $15. Blade 2, this was also 15. Wesley Snipes. Trying to find out which issue this is. This is actually a poster book. Did not know that. I just looked it up. I thought this was the comic. Nope. So if you're a big fan of Wesley Snipes, there you go. I dig it, Wesley Snipes, but I'm not that big of a fan that I need a comic book size photo album of him. I didn't know that. Oh well. Damn. Never thought this was gonna end up being a poster book. Great. Yay! $15, because I didn't look inside. Didn't think I needed to. Some 80s goodness. $25, first print, near mint. $9.99, newsstand, first appearance of the Stepford Cuckoos, new X-Men 118 from around 2002, I believe, Grant Morrison, Frank Quitely doing the cover, Ethan Van Sciver interiors.
Okay, yeah, that's Marvel's label though, Epic, so they can get away with it?
Yeah.
It's legal, so to speak?
Yeah.
I was going to say... Or is that Eclipse that was Marvel?
Because, it's Iron Man. And...
But back then, did they have the rights? Who knows? I mean, if it's Innocenti and Bolton, they probably did, I guess. Yeah.
Well, Epic was Marvel's label.
Okay, that's Epic.
Yeah.
But then what was the label that printed Miracle Man? Was that Marvel's label? Or well, wasn't then Eclipse?
Eclipse was...
That was not Marvel, my bad.
Yeah,
that's right.
Yeah,
that's
it was
right.
Independent. But Marvel's now bought up all the rights for it.
They did. 2011. Yeah. So what is that then? Someplace Strange. Why did you get that?
Just because of Bolton.
Because you're a Bolton fan?
Yeah.
Right, huh? It's like a collage art almost.
Yeah.
It looks like late 80s, maybe like 1990?
Yeah. Oh, it's 87.
Yeah. Okay, yeah.
Can I open this?
Yes, sir. Right here, yes.
Thank you.
Just want to move that taper. Make sure the tape doesn't get on there.
Yeah. I'll let you do it.
There you go. Yeah, I'm
just going to get
it. That reminds me of heavy metal, that type of artwork.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Really nice. Nice quality paper as well.
Yeah. Well, Marvel did these series of graphic novels in the 80s. He's got a bunch of them here. And there's a lot of good stuff.
I had no idea that there were that many. I know like there's the God Loves, Man Kills or something like that.
Yeah.
From the,
Let's see, there's another Bolton.
Murata.
And there's Bernie Wrightson. There's Gil Sienkiewicz.
Can I see that? Can I see that Sienkiewicz Daredevil, please?
Yeah.
Hell yeah. That's only $20? That's not bad condition. What do you think that is? Do you think that's a VF?
Yeah.
No. You think?
Yeah. Let's see.
If that's a VF, I don't get it.
A lot of people don't know about these.
Yeah,
there's a lot of good things in there.
It never occurred to me to go for it. Just give this guy some room here.
Oh, you're okay.
Okay. But yeah, no, I'm gonna get this because I mean, Jesus, this combination of Miller and Sienkiewicz.
Yeah,
that's with this condition.
Yeah.
Kind of for me, I'm a fan of both these two names. So that's some money I'm about to spend.
Yeah, that's like a yeah, that's one thing.
Thanks for showing the John Bolton.
Yeah.
You know, John Bolton, some of his horror stuff I have.
Yeah.
And then he did those backup stories in Classic X-Men.
Yeah.
Those were awesome.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking too.
Yeah,
you
figure that shit out. Frank Miller and Simon Beasley.
Whoa. Yeah, like I said, I'll freaking
send them your card right now. Can I see that? Is that yours? I mean, are you gonna,
no,
are you gonna grab it?
I already have it at home.
It's another good combination, as a matter of fact. Huh. I gotta get picky about my spending, but depends on how the interiors look in this.
Yeah.
But it's very tempting. Yeah, because the bees, man. The biz.
Yeah.
The bees, however you say it. Yeah. The biz. Ain't no other. Where was this? To be safe, I'm gonna put this back.
Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah, Frank Miller and Beasley. Shit. Duty. Oh, no way. Are these $2 each? Hold up.
Wonder Woman, is that something you're interested in?
Yeah, we got some of this.
A dozen of them. The fuck? Don't do me like that. We got first echo or some shit? No, of course not. There's no more. 10 is missing. 10. James Stokoe. Number 10 is missing. Don't know why. Alright then.
Boom, Godzilla. Pretty fucking dope. Was the shit back in the day from the hit TV show Avi Arad and his incompetence in effect.
Yeah, I pulled the trigger on this one. Very psyched to get this. Nice. It's at least VF. $20, Frank Miller. Nice high grade. Bill Sienkiewicz. Work here on this Marvel graphic novel that whenever I find it, it's always beat up, riddled with spine ticks, corners dented. And when I found this one, couldn't resist. $20. Holla. Now. My haul from last December, I think it was the new Marvel one, about 6 months ago, I showed off the newsstand for this. So I managed to get issue one in direct, story written by Grant Morrison, art by Frank Quitely, art and covers. We got ourselves here, check this out. It's the Neil Adams cover. I don't know what incentive it is. How rare. But they both say 00111. Let's not forget the free comic book day. So All-Star Superman, this 12-issue limited series, it came out in January 2006 cover date. And then the Free Comic Book Day All-Star Superman, that first issue reprint, is from 2008. After Watchmen, this reprint is from 2009. Let's not forget 2013, when the Man of Steel movie came out, the special edition reprint of All-Star Superman number 1 by Grant Morrison and Frank Quitely. But the special edition right here, and then right here we got ourselves the Sears special edition. It's polybagged, except the polybag is disintegrating. It's like... something to keep in mind. Oh, look at that. See how I put the tape over it? Isn't that great? Alright. Yeah, see pieces of the poly bag just falling out? Yeah. Hey, comic is still intact. Rebag this baby. But yeah, if you see the Sears one, it does originally come in the poly bag, in case you didn't know. A couple copies right here from 2013. Now, when I was looking through a set, you know, I found these for $2 a piece at the con. Number 2, number 3, number 4, number 5, number 6, number 7. Love Frank Quitely. One of my favorite artists, I'd have to say. I like this story. It was like Jim Steranko, bittersweet. I didn't want to leave, but I had to go. I can't stay in Denver forever. This is about the death of Superman, this story. 8 and 9. Yeah, very bittersweet story right here. And then number 11. Right. So I'm hunting, and what do I find at another spot? at another booth, another table, but issue 12. So I'm missing number 10. Just before I left, at that table that was right by the entrance, I just looked in one box, just for the hell of it. It was crowded, there was only one box available for me to directly look at while I was leaving. 3 seconds into looking in to one of the short boxes that was available for me to reach. Just one more final hunt, right? Boom, what do I find? Issue 10. So I managed to get all 12 issues by working the hunt. Thank you very much.
Sweating on my comics. Swamp Thing, number 85. Talk to me, Hellrider. Come on now. Show me Hellrider, number one. Very tempting.
There's stuff scattered throughout. Is there particular things you're looking for? No, I think there's like six.
Judgment Day. Awesome. These are awesome. Focus. Flash. Playboy's Little Annie Fanny, $100. Awesome. Harvey Kurtzman and Will Elder. Kelly Jones, damn. $90, first print. Aliens Hive. This is the library edition. No, this is the original edition. The library edition, this was renamed to Aliens Harvest. So this is the first print. I believe.
I need a couple things.
All trade paperbacks are picking up steam. Maybe not, this is what, just 15? Three for five. $25 first print, Sin City. That is not a bad deal. The Empire Strikes Back. Here we have the likeness of Harrison Ford on a comic book for $10. Not bad. And we got decent spine. Tempting to get the likeness of Harrison Ford. Books of Magic, Spider-Man, Doctor Strange. $5. More affordable in the back. $25. $25. Savage Tales, number one. I believe that is. Sure. Savage Tales number two. Let's see if we got number four. No! There's no Savage Tales number four. James O'Barr's first professional work. Not listed. That's okay. We'll leave it on there. Spider-Man 15. Got a few here that I was interested in getting. When you get a moment and see your, I'm in no rush, man. Don't have issue number 10, but I'm gonna get out. These are $2 a piece. And this one is 20. So
that was a good book too, by the way.
Yeah, I dig that. That Simcovich.
Awesome book.
Do you take debit?
Yes, we do.
Good. That helps.
So these are $2, by the way. You're aware of that, right?
Yes, okay, yeah, that's good.
2, 4, 6, 8, 10. 2, 4, 6, 18. And 20 would be 38.
Great.
At 38, correct?
Yes. Just trying to get a close-up, but my lens is so grainy, it doesn't really do close-ups too well. And then a rickshaw, but the prices are ran over.
How much is that 6.0 House of Secrets? I'm just curious if you have a... I'm not going to buy it. I just...
I have 2,300 on it.
Cool.
Yes, sir.
Bernie writes in goodness.
Bernie writes in, dude. Doesn't get any better than that. I enjoy, like, a lot of the Bernie writes and Alan Moore stuff that they did with
Swamp Thing, yes.
And other obscure stuff, you know. It's just awesome.
You have a great selection, by the way.
Thank you so much.
That Mobius, what is that, Airtight Garage? What is that?
So, you know who Mobius is,
correct? Yeah,
okay, so
France.
This is the English version of when they did the UK version of Airtight, Garage Airtight, is what that was.
Okay. So that's, not familiar with it at all, right now.
So that's all English, that's...
Is it cyberpunk, or what is it?
It's not really its own cyberpunk, thing. But it's
its own, yeah.
He did a version of metal, something metal, not heavy metal, but something metal UK. And this was European, but then they transferred this over by Epic Comics to an English version, which became Mobius Airtight Garage.
Okay.
So that's what that was.
Thank you.
Yeah, no problem.
Do you need me to sign?
I will ask you for your zip code here really soon. So here's your card, and what is your zip code?
80113. 80130.
80130.
Correct.
Perfect. Awesome. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks.
And perfect. Awesome. Would you like a text, email, or no receipt?
No receipts.
No? Okay, perfect. Would you like a bag for that stuff there?
No, I'm good.
Yeah? Yeah, perfect.
Thanks.
Well,
appreciate your help.
I'm glad you found some good reads there. Definitely enjoy that.
Yeah. I had a great time talking to Steranko, man.
Oh,
and
wow. I bet that was amazing.
It was.
That was awesome.
What's the name of your store?
I have a card here. I'm an independent dealer.
Oh, okay, cool.
So the name of the company is called Same One Comics. So we're on social media.
Awesome.
You know, Instagram. We do a lot of online stuff. So that's who we are.
Yeah, from Colorado?
From Colorado, yes, sir. Yeah.
Great, man. Passing on.
So, yeah, so anything you need or so, do you have my information? Is there stuff you're looking for?
Just kind of, wrapping it up today, but it's hard not to spend money.
No.
So.
Well, at a place like this, right? It's like comic book heaven, man.
I'm like sweating. I love smaller cons like this just because people here are more friendly and
it's not crowded, right?
Yeah, exactly. It's easier just to get around. There's AC Canales. Yes, the founder of Odd Mausoleum. If I'd say so, right? Vision Comics and Presents. Grab a stash here.
Go right ahead.
Thanks.
You're welcome. Enjoy it.
Thank you.
I feel like in the face, a little bit sinister reminds me a little bit of how Bart Sears draws stuff.
Okay.
You know, because like, I try to get that, this little, I guess, outline of the skeletal structure in the face is always the same.
To me, this looks more like, a bit more like Jim Lee-esque. This looks actually a bit more like McNiven. His Wolverine.
McLovin. That's what he was going for. Can't you tell by the eyes?
I was looking for like a little Silvestri, a little bit of Finch influence there as well. Their hatching is a lot sharper than mine, but yeah, it still looks good.
Yeah, man, I dig the She-Hulk's good. The She-Hulk is good. But I really like the Spawn and the Wolverine that you did. Cool. Is this inspired by Spider-Man 2?
Yeah, I like the black and red suit. I like the Doc Ock thing, you know, getting that shine on everything, the reflection. I had a background on this initially, and it looked good, but when I printed it out, I just decided to take it out. It didn't pop the way I wanted.
Could I get a video really quick of that comic that you had where you compiled all your stories from the Vision Comics and Oddities comic?
Shall receive. Here it comes.
Just a cool cover, and I like that concept.
Thank you. Coming right up, and I'll get
nice,
both
dog
versions out here. I've got the
Shadow and Vice, because her name's Gazelle, right?
It's Ysel.
Ysel.
It sounds like Gazelle. It's supposed to sound like Gazelle. Because that's her, she's like graceful and fast.
Yep.
That is her whole thing.
But Shadow and Vice.
It's more that, like, everyone in it is kind of dark. Everyone in it has flaws.
Yeah.
And the flaws kind of drive the story.
Nice. If I didn't already have these, probably would get it. But no, I love that. That's awesome, man.
I appreciate your support, man. Thank you. I
appreciate what you do. Nice talking to you, AC.
Good talking to you, too. See you right
Peace, man. James O'Barr. $20 a piece. Numbers 1, 2, 3, and now we got ourselves some Flesh and Blood. Yeah. Dead time. Yeah. Angela.
I'd like to see the music. I'd like to see what the music looks like.
Yeah,
is that written down?
How to describe it? Yeah.
And then when Palmer,
hey, quick question. I see you had those O'Barr Crow over there. Do you have any of the O'Barr comics that he did, like for IDW?
All I got is those.
Just those? Okay. Yeah. But...
And then
thank you.
Sure. And then Palmer quit. Paul came in for an album or two, which was fine.
Yeah, but I don't think anybody.
I never said it. Paul, I like that. But
I didn't think
now two of them are dead. One was cancer. One was suicide. The keyboardist, because he got Keith Emerson, who shot himself, couldn't play keyboard anymore because of his hands. Is that what it was? Not arthritis.
$50.
Worse, right? Was it arthritis?
Arthritis will do it to you, man. I can't even make a fist in my
poor guy. But Palmer continues to do stuff. So.
Palmer's a drunk.
So
Lake is the guitarist. We wrote a lot.
Honey, did we get food at a concert?
Yeah.
Greg Lake was the guitarist.
Okay. So the drummer from Genesis. What's his name?
Phil Collins.
Phil Collins.
He's the lead singer.
Yeah, no, he's got problems. He can't
die. Well,
no, he's still alive, but he's got
problems.
Yeah.
Not him, but it's
Peter Gabriel. Richie, Betty and Veronica.
Children of the Crypt, 20,
34, 30. Fantastic Four.
No, I think they're all in
30. 30,
30. He had nerve damage.
Hey, you don't have any modern comics. I'm looking for the 10th issue. I almost have a full run today just from, you know, hunting. It's all good. Just need number 10. I love that. Starting a run from scratch. One more to go. You don't have any modern comics like this title, do you?
All-Star Superman don't have any.
Okay. Thank you. So, do you have All-Star Superman, any of these? I'm looking for issue 10. I found almost a run, and I'm missing number 10.
I don't think I have the rest of it here.
You know, you don't tell that to people visiting cons.
You dug through everything already.
Yeah.
I mean, I know I have like a bunch of them. I don't know if I have 10.
Fuck yeah, look at this shit.
It's really old. It's from like 1992. Oh, well, actually, so it's 30 years old.
Awesome.
Yeah. It's 3 years old. Well, that's what scares me is when you start seeing these.
Thank you.
And then after I left, took off, I don't know, around 2:30, I was there 10 to 10 in the morning. Stopped by City Records. This is a new shop that opened up, I don't know, like 4 months ago, 3 months ago, on Colfax, more towards downtown. So do not go to All in a Douche Comics, which is farther down on Colfax. It's a lot more convenient and a lot better service and cooler people if you go to City Records. The guy over at All in a Douche Comics, farther down on Colfax, he likes to play off that he's senile. He's just a rude, mean son of a bitch that kicks people out and closes early. City Records. Just opened up. Hell of a back issue selection. Not a lot of back issues, but they got quality from indie and Marvel and DC. So there you go, City Records, new shop. Actually didn't get anything there because their prices, they are pricey. So I went over to Kilgore Books, which is within walking distance. What did I get? I got a bunch of indie stuff I want to show real quick. This was a dollar. I don't know what Kwileoth is, like some area. This woman here with the wings and the hooves. That's the Zora. Yeah. No idea what this is about. It's like some zany indie stuff. Very nicely made. Very well. Something fun to read. Indie mini comic. I love stuff like this, showing styles, incorporating some modern aspects of living. People experimenting with some old school electronics. I've noticed a lot with these indie artists, there's a lot of anthropomorphic or like animals, humans, combination of humans and animals type of looks. This was free. This is free comic. So here's how you make your free comic. There you go, and then you fold it up. There you go, anyone can do that. This guy, I've shown off his stuff before. Carl Christian Krumpholz. He's a famous name here in the Denver area. Famous cartoonist. Writer, artist, inker. Does his own stuff. And this cat, he had this online comic book that he ended up printing out. Physical form. Got pretty well known. Pretty well liked. So I heard about Ula, this cat. I wanted to get this and check it out. I don't think this is a first volume because it says it's reprinting these volumes 6, 8, 9, and 10. So, whatever, 1 through 5 must be the first printing of the physical form of these from 2022. So. Kilgore Books. There you go. Little indie shop. They used to have publishing, but that moved to the Washington, D.C. area. So now you have Kilgore Books, separate company. It's a bookstore. They still collaborate, but the bookstore still remains in Denver. Up in 13th and Pearl. Mineshaft. I grab these up occasionally because I'm looking for some just more recent Robert Crumb published works, but if you're indie and you got talent, you're probably going to end up being in Mineshaft. Jay Lynch, ladies and gentlemen. Christian Mueller. I met him at the Coventry ComicCon in 2019, I believe it was. There's a video I did on that. Chilled out. Had a chance to hang out with this guy for 10 minutes when he was having a break. This is some more of his stuff. He does a lot of portraits. He's got a book of stories as well. By William Creek, these illustrations here. Excerpts from R. Crumb's Dream Diary. That's one consistent contribution to this mineshaft, are the R. Crumb's Dream Diary. It's from 2017, it says, so I thought this was 2015. It says here 2017. R. Crumb drawing. Who is this? Ed Piskor doing arts for Jay Lynch story. Is that winter 2018? These are $9.99. Or excuse me, $9. Here we have a Charles Bukowski story with art by Pat Moriarty. Right here. Bukowski. Love him. Stuff here by Chris Mueller. I showed off Cosmic Beings. I know the second and third issue, Alex Graham. I finished this. It's awesome. There is some political commentary, but there's commentary on sex, there's commentary on drugs, there's commentary on losing your job, keeping your job, breaking up with somebody or not, living with people, dating your boss, hooking up with your housemate, all the head games and drama that comes involved with dealing with that during the first year of the pandemic. This is an awesome book. This was so much fun. Anthropomorphic. There's some humans in here, mostly. It takes place in Seattle. But you got some people that are like part dog, part rabbit. That trend's going on big time. Simon Hanselman, for example, is big on doing that, and he actually helped Alex Graham out, this woman. She's originally from Denver, but she's been living in Seattle for like, I don't know, 20 years maybe? For a while. And considering that Alex Graham has been living in Seattle, and the point of views that she expresses in this, I was pleasantly surprised. Awesome book. Devil's Grin. Don't know what this is about. I know it's issue 2, and it's expensive. It's $14. But it's something new, and I like Alex Graham. I've shown off her other stuff from her. And she has Cosmic Beings. I think there's like at least 3 issues. I don't know how many, but it's at large size like this. Let's take a look, shall we? sure. What do we got here? Author's note. Printed editions of this comic in limited runs of 250 each. If you missed the previous editions, they are likely sold out. If you'd like to read The Devil's Grin in its entirety at this point, you can do so at my Substack, alexgraham.substack.com. There you go. Forget when we are in Kilgore Books to always grab some bubbles, right? So I got issue 1 and issue 6. One, because it's the first issue, and I got issue 6 because it's featuring Ben Mara. I also specifically grabbed the ones that have these, like, you know, material that's been edited out that they've added on here. I think it's like a limited run in that sense. This particular case looks like we're dealing with some music. Yeah, they cover everything indie, even underground comics from Japan. Interview with James Hudnall. Section on eBay finds. Pretty cool. Ben Mara. He is on the channel Power Comics, if you're into that whole smug, higher-than-thou way of presenting comics. Not for me. I've tried it so much. The information that they have at Power Comics is great. I just can't deal with the whole higher-than-thou with them and kayfabe. It's too much humble bragging. They're too pseudo-modest for my taste. Bubbles Fanzine, Richmond, Virginia. Alright, sorry about that. Uh-huh. I just did that. Whoops. Let's see how the rest of this goes. Ben Mara. Interview by Dash Shaw. Cool. He's another comic book, indie comic book creator. Right, Night Business. You might know that. He did some stuff for Fantagraphics, like a pseudo superhero. All American Comics imprint out of Fantagraphics. Ben Mara did. Says. Thank you, Jim Steranko, the man. very gracious with his time. Unbelievable. Really. Myself, my Rocky Mountain Con wristband. So, that's all she wrote. Comic book haul for y'all. And that's it, man. I appreciate y'all watching. Thank you so much. Thank you, Mr. Eddie Lockjaw Davis. Show you saxophone greats. Thank you, Mr. Jim Steranko and the people of Rocky Mountain Con. And to all my viewers, thank you. Thank you for swinging by. Much love. Till next time. Peace. Thank you. Thank you very much, man. I appreciate everything.